Hello, my name is Anthony Sung. I'm a hematology-oncology fellow at Duke University Medical Center, and I'll be talking about neutropenia. I'll begin today talking about the definition of neutropenia, followed by a discussion of its causes, how to work up neutropenia, how to treat it, and by discussing the management of febrile neutropenia. Neutrophils, also known as polymorphonuclear cells, or polys, or segmented cells, are the most abundant white blood cell in the body and crucial to fighting infections. The absolute neutrophil count can be calculated as the total number of white cells multiplied by the percentage of neutrophils in bands, which are an immature form of neutrophils. If the ANC is less than 1500, this is defined as neutropenia. Some people will break up neutropenia into mild, moderate, or severe based on an ANC of 1,000 to 1,500, 500 to 1,000, or less than 500. However, more important than the actual number of cells is the body's ability to fight infection. After all, this number only mentions the number of neutrophils in the blood, but does not take into account the number of neutrophils in the bone marrow, reticular endothelial system, tissues, etc. What matters is whether someone is functionally neutropenic, that is, more susceptible to infections. Neutropenia can be caused by four broad categories of problems: decreased production of neutrophils where your body is not making them, ineffective granulopoiesis, which is a problem in the development of neutrophils, shift to tissue pools, that is, out of the blood, and increased destruction. You can see how some of these causes, such as shifting of neutrophils to tissue pools, may not cause a functional neutropenia, while other causes, such as decreased production, can make a big difference. There is a long list of causes of neutropenia. Main division is into acquired and congenital causes. The most common acquired cause is infection, followed by drugs, which we'll talk about later. Primary immune or autoimmune neutropenias can occur when the body makes antibodies against neutrophils. Neutropenia has also been found in association with collagen vascular diseases, such as lupus and rheumatoid arthritis, as can be seen in Felty syndrome, the triad of rheumatoid arthritis, splenomegaly, and neutropenia. Complement activation, such as by dialysis or ECMO, can also result in increased destruction of neutrophils, whereas hypersplenism causes neutropenia by increased sequestration and clearance. Nutritional causes such as low B12, folate, or copper can cause production problems, as can bone marrow disorders such as MDS or leukemia. Finally, there are idiopathic cases where the cause cannot be found. Congenital cases include benign familial neutropenia, which is a neutropenia found in certain ethnic populations such as West Africans and their descendants, Yemeni Jews, Cretans, and so forth. In this patient population, the neutropenia is mild and usually not a functional neutropenia. There are also a lot of congenital neutropenia syndromes such as cyclic neutropenia, Kostman's, Schwann-Diamond-Oski, Chediak-Higashi, myelokathesis, reticular dysgenesis, dyskeratosis congenita, glycogen storage disease such as von Gierke's disease, and X-linked syndromes such as Wiskott-Aldrich and Bruton's A gamma globulinemia. The most important thing in distinguishing acquired from congenital causes is whether the patient has a history of neutropenia or if this is a new development. Although infections typically cause a leukocytosis and increase in neutrophils, many viruses such as HIV, EBV, CMV, the hepatitides, HHV6, measles, rubella, varicella, and dengue can all cause neutropenia. Neutropenia can also be seen in bacterial infections, particularly with brucella, shigella, and mycobacteria, as well as in rickettsial diseases such as typhus, Rocky Mountain spotted fever, and ehrlichia, as well as parasitic diseases such as leishmania and malaria. Drug-induced neutropenia requires the offending drug to be administered within 4 weeks of the development of neutropenia. However, it typically develops within the first 3 to 6 months of drug administration and resolves 30 days after discontinuation of the offending agent. Drugs can cause neutropenia in many ways. The first and most obvious form is myelosuppressive drugs, where chemotherapies such as cyclophosphamide or anthracyclines exert a direct effect on the bone marrow and impair production of neutrophils. This can be also seen with immunosuppressants such as azathioprine, antivirals such as ganciclovir, or rheumatologics such as colchicine. Immune-mediated destruction of neutrophils can also occur, such as with thyroid medications like propylthiouracil, or with direct toxicity to neutrophils from a metabolite of drugs such as clozapine. There is a very long list of drugs that can cause neutropenia, and so I'm not going to spend time going over each one of these, but I do want to point out a few common drugs that we all use, such as NSAIDs, H2 blockers, diuretics, penicillins and other antibiotics, and many psychotropic drugs. The investigation of neutropenia starts with taking a history, asking about comorbid conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis, new medications such as propylthiouracil, or recent infections can point to the cause of neutropenia. Symptoms, again such as recurrent infections or abdominal pain, can suggest the severity and degree of functional neutropenia. The exam should focus on the oral cavity and skin or catheter sites where ulcerations, abscesses, or signs of infection are prominent. A large spleen can suggest hypersplenism. Avoid doing a rectal exam as this may introduce bacteria. Lab work, such as a CBC, is essential to establishing neutropenia, and the peripheral smear can give insight into whether there is a bone marrow disturbance. LDH and ESR can give a sense of inflammation. Viral studies can look for a cause of neutropenia. Autoimmune workup, such as ANA, C3, C4, rheumatoid factor, and anti-neutrophil antibodies can work up autoimmune etiologies. I should point out that caution should be taken in interpreting anti-neutrophil antibodies, as they have a high false negative rate. B12, folate, copper, and ceruloplasmin studies look for nutritional deficiencies, and flow cytometry, test of T-cell gene rearrangements, and bone marrow biopsy can evaluate for malignancies such as LGL or MDS. It should be stressed that this laboratory workup is not a list of tests that should be ordered anytime someone is neutropenic, but a set of guidelines for working someone up. For example, if a patient has arthralgias and other rheumatologic syndromes, ANA, complement, and so forth would be perfectly appropriate, whereas someone with megaloblastic changes should have B12 and folate sent. Finally, a cause may not be readily apparent, and it is important to follow these patients over time to see how they develop. Treatment of neutropenia depends on the cause. If neutropenia is secondary to an underlying problem such as an infection, treat with antibiotics. If secondary to drugs, withdraw the offending agent. If an autoimmune phenomenon, start or increase immunosuppression. If from hypersplenism, consider splenectomy. If nutritional deficiency is present, supplement this. And if a bone marrow disorder, such as MDS or leukemia, treat with chemotherapy. However, primary or idiopathic neutropenia is trickier. Watchful waiting is the main approach that should be taken. As was mentioned in the beginning of this talk, what's important is not just a patient's neutrophil count, but also whether they are functionally neutropenic. Do they have increased infections and hospitalizations? Antibiotics are not generally recommended for prophylaxis and neutropenia, except in special cases, such as prolonged neutropenia following chemotherapy, such as induction chemotherapy for leukemia. Growth factors can be used to increase the neutrophil count in platelets who are functionally neutropenic with frequent infections, and may result in decreased infections and use of antibiotics. Granulocyte transfusions can directly boost a patient's neutrophil count, but are associated with a number of immune complications and are generally avoided. Finally, for severe refractory neutropenia, bone marrow transplant can be considered. Febrile neutropenia is a special circumstance that is important to address. Again, a response depends in part on the severity of neutropenia. Some guidelines recommend that someone with an ANC of greater than 1,000 can actually be treated normally as if they were not neutropenic, whereas fever in a patient with less than 500 neutrophils warrants immediate hospitalization and the administration of IV antibiotics. However, again, it is important to look at the clinical context. The importance of febrile neutropenia stems from the fact that a patient with lacking neutrophils cannot put up a good response to infection, particularly from gram-negative rods, and is at increased risk of infection-related mortality. With regard to empiric antibiotic therapy, patients who are febrile neutropenic should be covered with an anti-pseudomonal beta-lactam, such as ceftazidime, cefepime, or zosyn. For severe sepsis, an immunoglycoside and vancomycin can be added. Vancomycin should also be added in cases where a skin or oral source is suspected, such as line infections. Although antifungals are typically not initiated in the beginning unless other factors are present, such as nodular infiltrates on a CT, there should be a low threshold to start antifungals if patients remain febrile after 48 to 72 hours of adequate antibiotic coverage, as above. In summary, neutropenia is defined as ANC less than 1500, although it is important to take into account whether someone is functionally neutropenic and at increased risk of infections. Acquired versus congenital causes can be separated based on whether there is a history of neutropenia. Common acquired causes include infection, drug-induced neutropenia, autoimmune phenomena, nutritional deficiencies, and bone marrow disorders. History is essential to determining the etiology of neutropenia and how secondary causes of neutropenia can be treated. For primary neutropenia that results in multiple infections, consider growth factor support. And remember the importance of empiric anti-pseudomonal antibiotics in febrile neutropenia. Below you can find some references for more reading on neutropenia. And I would like to conclude by thanking Dr. Carlos De Castro as well as Duke Hematology Oncology. Thank you.